Penguin Random House Audio presents Rake's Progress, the Madcap True Tale of My Political Midlife Crisis. This is the author, Rachel Johnson. To Ivo Dorney. Dorney was greater than thousands of baggage camels. T.E. Lawrence, Seven Pillars of Wisdom. Logical argument versus emotional argument equals political defeat. David Cameron, 2019. Author's note. I am known to family and old friends as Rake, which I hope explains my ironic choice of title. My older brother is known to family and old friends as Al, not Boris, which is how he was repurposed at age 13 after boys at school sacked his room and discovered his passport and corrected his full name in the document to Alexander Boris de P.P. Johnson. I'm afraid I use both names at random in what follows. Part 1. Chapter 1. World King. To adapt Tolstoy, all families are special, but big families are, simply by virtue or demerit of their size, more special than standard issue families just because of this one thing. There are more of you. The infinite scope for conflict, friction, jollity, japes, scrapes, fights, and sheer visibility. On a clear day in the UK, it feels as if you can see and hear the blonde tribe of the Johnsons from space is multiplied exponentially by the number of its members. No surprise, then, that large, noisy public families have a grip on the public imagination. The Mitfords, six daughters, one forgotten son, crazy Favre, who hunted his own children to hounds, submissive mother. The Kennedys, the royal family, the Waltons. As you can sense, I am already running out of famous clans quite quickly before I fasten on my own. It is a trope that every country regards itself as exceptional, while every child thinks his or her childhood, however peculiar, is normal, because that is all they know. That wasn't the case in our family. I think we all knew, right from the beginning. I definitely knew our family was different. From about the age of 3, I would lie in bed as I heard the grown-up shouts of laughter over those raffia-covered pregnant bottles of cheap Chianti and breathed in their cigarette smoke, thinking, why am I part of this family and not another family? How did I end up here? My parents were in their very early 20s when they started reproducing. Looking back, I can't help measuring my life and even my adult children's lives against my parents' own early milestones, even though I realize my mother and father were basically babies when they had babies, and that fact alone explains a lot about how things turned out. My mother had 3 children by the time she was your age, I said to my oldest son the other day and watched him wince. When I got pregnant with you, the NHS considered me an elderly prima gravida and I was only 26. I'm not sure what the point of these comparisons is, but I was always aware that my parents were virtual prodigies because they married straight out of Oxford, had 4 kids, then divorced 17 years later. It was always just assumed that said kids would all go to Oxford and at least one of us, maybe more, my father went on to marry again and have 2 more children, so I am one of 6, and there is no limit to his ambition for his offspring, would become, at the very least, the most important person in the country. Years ago, people would start asking, did your brother always want to be Prime Minister? I would answer, no, He's far more ambitious than that. That was always the plan. In 1970, when I was five, a family friend came to see us in Primrose Hill. We lived in two houses in Primrose Hill. The first Johnson residence in NW1 was in Princess Road, bang next to our school, Primrose Hill Primary. The house was a new build brick box. My mother found easy to clean, or at least easier to clean, than our next house in NW1, a crumbling, Victorian, semi-detached, stucco-fronted affair opposite the shops on Regent's Park Road, where we moved shortly after my mother had a fourth baby, Joseph, and shortly before my father shunted the whole family to Brussels in 1973, and then sold Regent's Park Road over the phone to the journalist Simon Jenkins, who'd called to say his current girlfriend, Gail, a high-maintenance Texan actress who went on to transform my tiny bedroom in the extension into a California-style storage solution just for her shoes, wouldn't marry him unless he got our house. My father agreed, as he has never, to my knowledge, said no to anything. What was a chap to do? My father explained. Simon was, you know, very keen on Gail at the time. We weren't in either Primrose Hill or Regent's Park Road long. I remember the latter mainly for the times we left home to go to Casualty. One day Joe, 9 months, consumed some succulent fungus he'd found after crawling behind the washing machine in the basement. His eyes rolled back, he went a funny colour, and my mother had to rush him to University College Hospital where, as chance would have it, I was already an inpatient, having inhaled eggshell after Al made me choke with laughter over breakfast while I was in the middle of my boiled egg. This resulted in a collapsed lung and pneumonia. I was in hospital so long, I did morning lessons on the children's ward and received my own post. All my little classmates were ordered to write me cards. Maureen wrote, "At school, we have been making animals out of flet, i.e. felt, and I hope you better." And my best friend, Stephen Devaney, wrote, "I'm missing you a lot, especially because of the eggshell in your lung." Being in hospital remains one of my happiest childhood memories. My mother, now 77, gave me the Get Well cards, but still has the eggshell in a jar that she keeps in a special place, along with locks of baby hair and teeth, all to be dealt with in the fullness of time. "Your baby appears to be high, Mrs. Johnson," the accident and emergency doctor said, noting her return without surprise, and took Joe away to have his stomach pumped. I know how bad this sounds, but don't forget it was the 1970s. As someone commented at length below the line after a piece I wrote for The Telegraph about how much I relished my time at prep school, where it was mainly beating, early morning Greek, and predatory schoolmasters, today the Johnson children would be taken into care. Footnote. Here's some of the long comment under the line to my Telegraph piece in praise of boarding school. Rachel's commentary is extraordinarily revealing about her own family background. It is clear from her self-description as a lumpen parcel and of her so-called family life in Brussels in the 1970s that Rachel and her siblings were grossly neglected by any normal standards, emotionally, if not materially. Had they come from a different class background and located in Britain, they might well have found themselves on the at-risk register and referred to a social worker. Instead, they were rescued by the almost accidental intervention of the European school in Brussels and father's subsequent decision to follow the advice of an Eton housemaster. And on it went. Anyway, when this family friend paid his visit, Al would have been around 6 years old. He was born 15 months before me, yet I get furious if people don't know this, as I have poured so much time and money into mad, expensive, age reversal creams and a punishing fitness and diet schedule, and he very much has not. In this first memory, we were in the downstairs playroom, with its smart modern floor of cork tiles and modular furniture covered with polyester-clad thin foam cushions. We didn't have a garden, but went to Primrose Hill, or used the car park reserved for the other residents of the development affixed with large signs saying "No ball games" and "No dogs," where we used to play noisy games and thud balls percussively against our neighbours' garage doors. Once, when a man told us to stop, we told on him, and my father came out and shouted that if the neighbour told us off again, he would...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.